Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to all. Welcome to the Singapore Management University and to this lecture under the SMU Presidential Distinguished Lecturer Series. Thank you for joining us today. And of course, a very warm welcome to our speaker. Professor Ed Diener is a leading researcher in the science of happiness and subjective well-being. Thank you, sir, for taking time out from your busy schedule to be with us here this evening. Today's panel discussion will be moderated by Professor Arnold De Meyer, President of Singapore Management University. He will be joined by panelists Professor David Chan, Director of the Behavioral Sciences Institute at SMU. I would now like to invite Professor De Meyer up on stage to introduce our speaker. Professor De Meyer, please.
Professor Ed Diener, Professor of Psychology at the University of Utah and the University of Virginia, distinguished guests, students, colleagues and members of the SMU community, a good afternoon and a very warm welcome. I'm indeed delighted to welcome you here this afternoon for the fourth lecture in the Presidential Distinguished Lecture Series in 2016. This year, our speakers included the former president of Nigeria and Indonesia, who spoke about national development and government, and our own provost, Professor Lily Kong, who discussed religion in space last month. Some of you may perhaps also remember that a while ago, Professor Jonathan Haidt spoke in January 2015 on the topic of can money really buy happiness, a topic of relevance also to today's subject matter. As I mention every time that we have this lecture, all of these lectures stimulated a vigorous intellectual debate among our SMU students, faculty and staff, not actually only during the lectures and the following receptions, but long after that too. And actually, that's the reason why I have this Presidential Distinguished Lecture Series. It's basically to bring people that can bring a slightly different opinion, a different point of view, and so that we can, as a good university, have a great debate. Our speaker today, giving the 26th lecture already in the series, is Professor Ed Diener, who is also known as Dr. Happiness. He is the alumni distinguished professor of psychology at the University of Illinois, where he has been a faculty member since 1974. And he is currently also a professor of psychology at the University of Utah and the University of Virginia. Professor Diener earned his bachelor's degree in psychology from the California State University in Fresno, and his doctorate in personality psychology from the University of Washington. He joined also Gallup as a senior scientist in 1999 and advises Gallup on research in psychological well-being. His current research focuses on the theories and the measurement of well-being. Temperament and personality influences on well-being, income and well-being, and cultural influences on well-being, and how employee well-being enhances organizational performance. I looked through the CV and I saw that Professor Diener received several prestigious scholarly awards from places like organizations like the American Psychological Association, the Association of Psychological Science, and the International Society of Quality of Life Studies, and there are many more. He has also been the past president of three scientific societies and is a fellow of five professional societies. He is, as you would expect with somebody with such a great resume, the editor. He has been the editor of respected academic journals and a co-author on several scholarly and popular books and has more than 330 publications. And even more impressively for the academics among us, he has more than 93,000 citations to his credit. I can only be jealous. I think we as a university can only be jealous, frankly speaking. Today, his lecture is Psychological Well-being and Public Policy. This is for us here in Singapore a very topical subject, as there is a growing awareness that economic indicators, important as they are not really adequate to guide policy and maximize quality of life. Policymakers are increasingly looking beyond the GDP in their policy deliberations to take into account measures of well-being, including happiness. After the main lecture, as is usually the case, we will have a Q&A session. And in that Q&A session, Professor Diener will be joined by Professor David Chan, one of our own faculty members. He's professor of psychology and director of the Behavioral Sciences Institute at SMU, and he was the person who suggested to me to invite Professor Diener. He has translated science into practice to help many organizations here in Singapore understand how human behaviors are shaped by the social, cultural, and organizational settings people find themselves in. And he recently received the Public Administration Medal, Silver, for his contributions to various national issues in Singapore. Professor Diener is not a stranger to our organization. He has co-authored with several of our faculty members, including David, and Associate Professor Christy Skolen and Associate Professor William Toff were Professor Diener's PhD students when he was still at the University of Illinois and have collaborated with him. I'm truly happy to welcome here today Professor Diener. He's a rare academic who is truly respected as a real scholar, but also is known to be able to engage the general public with his books and lectures, which he will do today. He still has, I understand, a very warm heart for his students and obviously also for his family. Right? And I welcome Mrs. Diener here also. SMU is delighted to have him as a guest, and thank you all, and I hope you will enjoy the lecture. Please.
Thank you. So now somehow we need to get this up here. Do you do that or do I do that? Let's see. Maybe here. Who's they? Oh, there. Good. I thought they were ghosts. I wasn't sure where they were. I'm just going to correct one thing. I appreciate that nice introduction, but for all of the scholars out here, I know some of you are scholars and some of you are intellectuals, but not necessarily at the university. Use Google Scholar for your citation count because the one that he gave you, 93,000, is good, but the one that Google Scholar gives me now is 133,000. So somehow it finds more citations for you. So if you're up for tenure, use Google Scholar. So today I want to talk about an idea that I had. See which direction we're going here. About 15 years ago, I wrote an article in American Psychologist, which is the main thing for American Psychological Association, the major journal, saying we need to have national accounts of well-being. And the idea here is that societies do a great deal to track economic indicators. We look at unemployment and growth rate and GDP and inflation rate, 1,000 of them every day. We spend enormous amounts of money tracking the economy. We track some other things. We track crime and we track education to some degree. But I said we need to start tracking well-being of people, psychological well-being of people, and that can tell us a lot about how the society is going. It's not that I wanted to replace. I didn't want to be a rebel and throw out all economic development and say, let's all go and live on a farm and live a simple life. It was that I wanted economic development, but I wanted it to be wise economic development, and I thought the national accounts of well-being could supplement the economic indicators. So what is the subjective well-being I'm talking about? It's people's own evaluations of their lives, not other people saying, are you living right, but do you think your life is good? When you appraise your life, evaluate your life, do you think your life is going well? Do you feel your life is going well? How do we know that? We know that by asking about your life satisfaction, about your satisfaction with your marriage, your health, your job, do you like your job? We also know it by looking at whether you're enjoying life, because if you're enjoying life, you're feeling that things are going well. If you're always angry and depressed, things aren't going well from your perspective. We know it if you're optimistic. And then some people would also include things like the quality of your relationships, your meaning and purpose in life, the degree of mastery in your life, the skills, and so forth. So that broader than just subjective well-being. So these are the things that we would measure in order to track the well-being of society, not just individuals. So here is where I was coming from. When I graduated from college, this man was running for president, Robert Kennedy, and he wrote this: "Too much and for too long, we seem to have surrendered personal excellence and community values in the mere accumulation of material things. Our gross national product counts air pollution and cigarette advertising, ambulances to clear our highways of carnage. Yet the gross national product does not allow for the health of our children, the quality of our marriages, the intelligence of our public debate, or the integrity of our public officials. It measures neither our wit nor our courage, neither our wisdom nor our learning, neither our compassion nor our devotion to our country. It measures everything in short, except that which makes life worthwhile." This may be an overstatement. I think economy does measure some of these things at least a little bit. But it is a statement that there's much more than just economic development, and we ought to be tracking those because societies pay attention to the things that are counted and to the things that we can have a metric for. So why then do we want national accounts of well-being? And I have four reasons here. The first one is because the citizens value it. And in modern society, we say we are here, the government, to deliver things to citizens that they want. And as I'll show you in a minute, Singaporeans value happiness. They value other things, but they value happiness, in fact, more than wealth alone. Secondly, the subjective well-being metrics tell us some things about quality of life that are not captured by the economic indicators. The economic indicators are good, but they miss big areas of life where a society can be doing well or not, and I'll show you some data on that. Subjective well-being has beneficial consequences. So what does this mean? This means that we want to measure subjective well-being just like we would measure education, because it itself produces good things. A lot of people think that happiness or well-being come from having a good marriage. Happiness or well-being come from doing well at work. We show that being a positive person with high well-being makes you do better in your marriage, makes you do better in your health, and makes you do better at work. So why would we want to monitor it? Because as a society, we have something to gain from making people prosperous in terms of well-being. And then finally, it helps you retain talent. So in the case of Singapore, if people are happy here with their jobs and they love Singapore, they're not going to want to run across the ocean and go work for Google as much, right? So that's the last reason. You retain talent if people really enjoy their lives here. Okay, so here is how much students, these are college students, and we have from around the world, but I've just put a few countries here, value happiness. And as you can see, overall, happiness is the number one value across 37, I believe, countries. Health is rated almost as high. The scale goes up to 9. 9 is extraordinarily important. 1 is not important at all. And as you can see, happiness is rated by the students as almost extraordinarily important and high, and certainly higher than wealth. In Singapore, it was rated the highest value. And next was health, and again, wealth down below. China, you can see, they rate health above happiness, but happiness still gets a high rating. So across the world that we found in every society, people would rate, and we have other data from the Gallup polls showing that people rate happiness as just extraordinarily important. So that's the first reason, and very simple to present. The next one is it picks up quality of life. So here is a map from the Gallup World Poll of virtually the entire poll. We can't get to certain places like North Korea, you see here. You don't want to go to Somalia and North Korea. But we have most of the world in the World Poll. These are representative samples. We have 1.5 million people, 165 countries. The first representative sample of humanity ever collected. And the dark green are places that are high in life satisfaction. And you can see that, you know, quite a bit of the Americas, New Zealand, Australia, Where do you see low, very low in Africa, Southern Asia and some of the countries, and especially in the Middle East, Oman and so forth, you see some very low levels of lysate and super low levels, Zimbabwe and certain countries. So what is going on here? Well, the first thing that's going on is if you have economic development, that is, you're a wealthy country, you're likely to have higher life satisfaction. So this is the first thing I want to say. Money is not unimportant. Money is important. I've never said, people say, oh, Diener says money's not important to have it. I've never said that for sure. Because this correlation's 0.82, pretty darn strong. The happiness, so here's Denmark, here's the U.S. U.S. is lower than Denmark, and you can see down here, Zimbabwe, African countries, and so forth, very poor. So money is important. Economic development is important. And yet, look at this, two countries, Korea and Costa Rica. One of them is a wealthy country. One of them is an up-and-coming country. Four times the income in South Korea is in Costa Rica. And yet the life satisfaction in Costa Rica is much higher than the life satisfaction in South Korea. Positive feelings, 88% say I felt positive much of yesterday. Here, only two-thirds did. And some people say, well, I don't believe in this is just self-report data, people saying they're happy. Oh, well, look at the suicide data then. You'll see the same thing. South Korea, highest suicide rate by far, and especially for women, in the 34 OECD countries. And all kind of other data that we get support these numbers. It's not just some self-report artifact of South Koreans saying they're unhappy. Committing suicide, we have other kinds of measures that support these. So what's predicting then besides income? So as you can see here, these are regression coefficients, betas. And as you can see, income is a big predictor of life satisfaction. But also, can you count on others? If you have an emergency, do you have somebody you can call? That, in a country, is very important. We call it social support. Treated with respect at work, enters. Satisfaction with education, enters. Beyond income. Okay, so things do matter besides income. But when you turn to positive affect, did you enjoy yesterday? Did you like yesterday? Now it becomes even more dramatic because here income does not enter in the top four. What you have is count on others, satisfaction with education, affordable housing, and treated with respect at work. These are the strongest predictors. So all of a sudden we say income is important, 0.82 correlation, but it's not everything. All right. The second one, and we'll come back to this and show you the other limits beyond money, of things that really matter beyond money. But I want to spend some time on the fact, because most of you don't know about these data yet, that happiness or well-being has downstream consequences that are usually beneficial. On average, happy people have better health, better jobs, better marriages, and are better citizens. A whole lot of data is now showing that. There are only a few studies that go in the other direction. Okay, so this guy was a skeptic, Flaubert. To be stupid, selfish, and have good health are three requirements for happiness, though if stupidity is lacking, all is lost. Okay, so he's saying you gotta be stupid to be happy, right? And there's a lot of intellectuals who believe that, right? But is he right? Okay, here's another one. Are you annoyingly happy? Despondex could be right for you, right? You look like an American here, smiling all the time and everything. So you want to look, more serious, to look really. Well, these are jokes, but they do represent, and there's a serious book or two out saying, Americans are getting in trouble now because they're too happy. All the data suggests that that's absolutely wrong. We find that happy people have better health and longevity, more supportive relationships, work performance, they're better citizens, and they're more resilient. So let's just talk about these briefly and start with health. So the Nun study is famous. How many of you have heard of the Nun study? A few of you. Okay, so I take credit for it. I wasn't an author, but I published it. I was the editor of the journal. And the reason I love the Nun study is the happy nuns live 10 years longer than the unhappy nuns. But the reason I love this study is they got the measure of happiness from their autobiographies when they entered the nunnery at age 22. They don't start dying until they're 75 and 80 and 90. So the measure of happiness could not be influenced by the fact that they were already unhealthy. You see what I'm saying? If you get a measure and then it predicts, you could say, well, they're already age 60, they already had some health problems. That's why the happy people live longer. They didn't have health problems. You can't use that for the nun study. The happiness measure was too early. The other reason I love it is that the nuns all live in the same circumstances, whether they're happy or not. They have the same housing. They have the same diet. Everything's the same. And the happy nuns tended to live to about 95. They live a really long time, right? And the unhappy nuns live to about 85, a 10-year difference between them, a huge difference. So then people say to me, well, Ed, we really can't believe that because that's nuns. And, you know, we drink and smoke and gamble and do all these bad things that nuns don't do. So maybe it doesn't generalize to the population as a whole. So I said, well, let's look at a more normal group of people, psychologists, right? So Sarah Pressman, a friend of mine, and we're working together, looked at psychologists' autobiographies that they wrote. And they were all famous psychologists, people like you see Freud here. And so these are famous people, and they had all written autobiographies, 72 of them. And she scored them for how happy their autobiography was and then how long they lived. The people that wrote, psychologists who wrote happy autobiographies, lived 5 or 6 years longer. The people who wrote about their relationships, not just their work, but they said, oh, I have a marriage, and you know, I'm married and I'm happy and all that, they live 5 or 6 years longer. So she found the same thing that was found in the other study, replicating it. This has been replicated over and over with much stronger and larger studies, studies stretching over long periods of time that use better measures of happiness and so forth. But then Sarah found my autobiography on the internet, and she ran it through the computer program, and she emailed me, Ed, I got something exciting to tell you. You are the most happy psychologist of any of the 75 that I've studied. I said, that's wonderful. I'm going to live a long time. I said, but I've got to tell you, I had read your study before I wrote my autobiography, so the causality may be reversed. I said, if I write this happy autobiography, maybe I'll live longer. Anyway, over and over, the same finding. Why? Why do they live longer? They have stronger immune systems. If you look at immune parameters, positive affect predicts, negative affect predicts worse immune parameters, more inflammation. Less inflammation, I'll show you a study that I just finished on inflammation and happiness. Less cardiovascular disease, blood pressure problems, heart attacks, and so forth. Better health behaviors, we'll talk about those in a moment. So here's our inflammation study. We just submitted it to a journal. We looked at people high and low in life satisfaction. And it's amazing to me that this would come out at all. It's amazing that it keeps coming out. People high in life satisfaction, and this is controlling for income and all kinds of things, were better off in terms of these immune parameters that we take biological assays for. Interleukin 6 and C-reactive protein. So what are those things? They're things floating around in you that tell us that you've got inflammation. Now, inflammation was a primitive immune system to attack things, when you get a cut or so forth. And inflammation had a good purpose, but a lot of times chronic inflammation is the thing that's going to cause hardening of the arteries, et cetera, these different problems. So you don't want a lot of inflammation in you all the time. You only want it there when it's really needed, and that's usually rarely in a society such as ours. So the fact that inflammation is greater for people low in life satisfaction opens them up to inflammatory diseases, you know, where your system's attacking yourself, and to various cardiovascular problems. Where you really see another difference is in health behaviors. Happy people do more health behaviors. Depressed people do them less often. On average, happy people are much more likely to exercise. Depressed people very infrequently exercise. They're more likely to smoke, unhappy people, more likely to use depressed people, alcohol consumption, unhealthy diet, and even less seatbelt use. So if you look at people high in life satisfaction, like 90% of people use seatbelts. It's a law, so you should, but it's in the U.S., but it's like 90%. And for people who are less satisfied, 80%. Still, most do it, but it's about 10%, which is several thousand lives a year saved in the U.S. So we see these kind of things over and over, leading us to believe, you know, this is why happy people tend, on average, there's exceptions, of course, it's an average, but tend to live longer. Here are my estimates of how big those differences might be. These are pretty rough and ready. They only come from one study each. Subjective well-being, 6 years. Not smoking, 7 years. Obesity. And you know, here you are doing all this exercise, but you better be happy because it's much bigger. And let me tell you where vegetables is. Your mother, my mother made me eat vegetables 1 year, right? Be happy. Don't eat vegetables. Be happy. So. And I have a student, Mark's son in Korea, he says, smoking makes him happy, so he's really not, you know, coming out bad. I'm not sure if it works. Social, happy people have better social lives, better marriages, less divorce, more sex, more friends. And in other words, married couples have more sex, they're more likely to be fertile if they're trying to have a baby, if they're in a positive mood. And here are some data to show you that. We've got the same pattern in four different countries, which is to say, people who are going to get divorced. So here is when something happens. You're going to get married, and you're going to get married. This is the group that will never, during the period of our study, get divorced. They're just happily married. This is the group that's going to end up getting divorced over here. And here's what happens. 5-6 years before they ever get married, they're still happier way back then. So it's not the marriage making them happy. It's not the meeting the person. They haven't met the person yet. And here they are, that different in happiness to begin with. Happy, and of course there's exceptions. Some happy people have unhappy marriages and so forth, but on average, people who are going to get married and stay married were happier from the very beginning. All right. So here's a young lady who's now in the front row of the audience with us today. I embarrass her every time I give a talk, and she has to come and see this slide. So we met when we were 16 years old. I fell in love with her, and we got married when we were 20. And I always say the thing that attracted me, two things, was she was very smart, and she was very cute. And but what I should have been worried, but now I've had a happy marriage for 50 years, what I should have been worried about, which I didn't realize at the time at age 16, is the smile. Because that smile, in a number of studies, predicts how long a woman will get, whether she'll get married and stay married and be happily married. And this is very interesting. It doesn't work for men, right? They're all trying to look like tough guys. But for women, it works. And so in other words, this is high school. This is way, well, in her case, it wasn't way before she met her husband. But for most of us, it is way before you ever meet the guy, right? But being a happy person means you have a greater likelihood of having a happy marriage. And of course, some happy people have unhappy marriages, and some unhappy people end up with a marriage, you know, of course. But this is the averages. Pro-social behavior, citizenship behavior, we find that happy people, for example, Mark Sa in Korea found that happy people donate blood more. We find happy people donate more to charity. Not only that, it's probably causal because when you put people in a happy mood, they're more likely to help other people. You know all the pro-social stuff in experiments where they put people in a happy mood in the lab and they go out and they help people pick up their books, or they stop to help somebody who looks like they're bleeding on the sidewalk, etc. They're more likely to intervene in emergencies and so forth, and they are more likely to give social support. We used to think that social support, having support from other people, caused you to be happy, but now we know that happy people give more social support to other people. That's what they're good at. These are data on income. We had 18-year-old college students. These are data that Danny Kahneman and I collected. 18-year-old college students, how cheerful are you in your freshman year of college? And then we followed them up at age 37, about 19 years later, and this is how much money they were making. Controlling for their major, controlling for their parental income, controlling for their occupation. And what you can see here is this is the not cheerful group, and this is the very cheerful group. And you know, you've got 65,000 versus, these are college graduates, 50,000. In other words, 30% higher income for the happy college students. We think it's mostly their social skills and so forth, but it's huge. Not only that, this has been replicated now in four different countries like Russia, Australia, Britain, and so forth. In the workplace, all right, happy people in the workplace, low stress, high well-being, low anger, end up being better on average in terms of productivity, and their firms then end up being more profitable for a whole lot of reasons. And I won't go through all these reasons because of the time constraints, but there's lots, they're less likely to turn over. Of course, happy people aren't going to quit. They have fewer sick days. They're more creative, etc. So because of that, what happens is workers in happy companies, that is companies that are good places to work, lead to a share price increase of about 6% over a year or two above the unhappy companies or less happy companies. It's huge. 6% in the stock market is huge. Realize the stock market's taking into account everything that stock buyers know about the company, and this happens beyond that. So it's a very big effect. So all the different reasons we have for thinking that happiness helps people. Why do you want to monitor it? Because they're good citizens and better marriage partners and harder workers, right? So do we want everybody to go running around being like that smiling American woman, right? Patting everybody, no. When we, so the Dalai Lama and I know the Dalai Lama, if there's Chinese people here, you don't love them, but anyway, the Dalai Lama and I have had a couple of these talks when you're on stage. And I said, is it ever bad to be happy? He said, oh yeah, there's stupid happiness. I said, what is that? He said, well, when a bear is chasing you and you're happy, that's stupid. There are times when you should be unhappy. There's times at your mother's funeral, you should be sad. There's times probably when you should be angry. So what we're talking about here is not having chronic, ongoing sadness, anger, and most of the time being happy. But we're not talking about being, you know, laughing and slapping everybody on the back and being euphoric. In Asia, for example, it's much more likely to be a calm happiness, a contented happiness, interest in what you're doing and feeling like what you're doing is important, that kind of thing. But if optimal happiness doesn't mean, you know, being the maximum. And we have studies to show that, in fact, some of that manic happiness is not always good for you. But anyway, I don't have time to talk about it, but just to reassure you that I don't want all of you to go out and, you know, be this super, you know, acting like, you know, punching the air kind of person. Because the calm, contented happiness is sufficient for this. All right. So I think we know what I've just said, so we'll skip it. Let me give you now the National Accounts of Well-Being where we started. So I'm going to skip through this because of time and just emphasize two of them. So I proposed that in the year 2000, and we started making progress. I talked to the UN, I talked to the World Bank about this idea, I wrote a book about this idea. David Cameron in the year 2010 said, we are going to monitor well-being in the United Kingdom for policy purposes. It was in November, I remember it very clearly when he said it. Huge, because this was a big breakthrough. Right? And then the Organizational for Economic Cooperation and Development, also huge, in 2013 wrote guidelines for countries to use in collecting well-being data. Why is that huge? Because they help coordinate the statistics for the 34 richest countries in the world, the US, etc. And so the fact that they wrote these guidelines has a very profound effect. And now, you know, lots of countries have been doing it to different extents. The United Kingdom and European countries the most, the US a little bit, monitoring the well-being. of their societies. So what do we find when we do that? What might we find about the good society? We find quite a few things lead to happiness and therefore the good society. One, we've talked about economic development, progressive income tax. We found so steep tax, richer people pay a higher percent tax related to well-being. Rights are protected, Diener, Diener, and Diener. So we've got five psychologists. We only have three of them here, but we wrote about that and data on that. Low inequality, redistribution. So we find that where there's more redistribution of income, so super big inequality in a country in terms of earned income, but the country redistributes some of that income. Never, of course, most of it, but some of it. The more they redistribute, the higher life satisfaction you'll see in those countries, with the Scandinavian countries usually coming out on top. And of course, the place that you do so well on, low corruption, another predictor of well-being. Beautiful thing, but I'm not going to go over it. I just wanted to show it. It was a really nice graph, but it just showed that thing I just told you about inequality. Okay, but it's not all about money. It's also about other factors. So the well-being measures are picking up very nice study on clean air and how that affects life satisfaction. So lower life satisfaction when you have a lot of air pollution. A place that Singapore has done so well on, given the growing population. I think it's amazing. You probably don't appreciate it as much as I do. Green space. This place, for the population and the size, has a lot of green space. And there's very strong data that green space increases people's life satisfaction. Active commuting, taking the bike to work, walking to work, rather than just driving to work. Jobs programs that give people security in terms of their job, income security programs, caregiver programs, et cetera. So the point here is that income and how income is distributed matters, but other things matter too for subjective well-being. And if we think about policies, because the talk of this is about policies, each one of these things, airport noise lowers subjective well-being. There's things that we can do policy-wise to reduce it, airport noise. Commuting, long, difficult commutes are bad for happiness. Not only are they stressful, but they take away from other things you enjoy in terms of time, less time with your family and so forth. There's things like zoning laws, very boring, but very important, things that societies can do to help with that. Parks and green space, obviously, again, zoning, et cetera, air pollution, et cetera. You know, putting catalytic converters on your car, emission constrictions on restrictions on plants and so forth. So there's things that governments can do to influence well-being. Some people say, oh, no, well-being's just within you, some Buddhist thing, right? You've got to meditate and all that. Well, of course, maybe that's important. But the society you live in is the biggest factor in terms of your subjective well-being, even bigger than the Buddhist and all those internal things, which are very big. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about beyond money. And post-materialistic world, I do think we're moving toward a post-materialistic world. What does that mean? Not that we're beyond materialism, not that money doesn't matter. Of course, we're all materialistic to some degree, and we're all concerned about income. But what we're concerned about is other things now, more and more. Like my grandparents, boy, they had to be concerned with income or they'd starve to death. And now we're beyond that, post-materialism. So I'm also worried not just make the most money I could. I'd be a CEO of a company. I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing because I also want, you know, development and other things. That's post-materialism. So here's an interesting thing. If you go to Silicon Valley, which people all over the world, if they're into computer stuff, want to go there. Why? Because they hear about the great pay and benefits. Oh my gosh, it's amazing how much they pay. Right out of college, they're paying you a huge amount of salary. They're gonna send a shuttle to pick you up and bring you to work. They have a dry cleaners at work if you need it. They have a restaurant, sometime with award-winning chef, right? Some Zagat guy comes over and cooks for Google. It's crazy. They have vacation time, no limit, whenever you need it. Relaxed dress, wear jeans, wear shorts, you don't have to dress like this. On-site gym and yoga class, we're gonna freeze your employees' eggs for you. Well, you know, so you can put off having a baby. Well, what as it turns out is, I'm going to show you in a minute, amazing amount of unhappiness in work there. Because all of these things are mixed blessings. Because a lot of it is saying, don't leave work. Work here 24/7. Oh, you can take vacation when you want it, but nobody else is taking it. So nobody takes any. If they said 2 weeks, you might take it. But when they say, do what you want, no, you can't do it. So look at these data. 19% of those people said they're happy in their job. Shocking. 17% felt valued. 30 clear career path. 28% they understand their company's vision. 47% good relations with other workers. Only half. In most companies, you see this number is very high. People like the other people at work. These are shocking numbers. Look at those benefits. Look at the pay there. This is proof for post-materialism that people care for more than just money. Here's more post-materialism, data that we just got from the Gallup World Poll. What this shows is low, medium, and high education groups, their life satisfaction, 0 to 10. 10 is, you know, ideal. 0 is terrible. And this is world data, 165 countries, and these are income going across here, as you can see, kind of a logs geometric scale. And what you see is you've got increasing, right? Money does matter. The more money you make, the more your life satisfied. Education also matters separately from income. But right up in here somewhere, around $160,000, $170,000, you start getting a downturn. Wow. Why is that? I don't know why it is. We just got this finding in. And this is the first finding of this type because you have so few people making this, you need 1.5 million people to get sufficient ends for these to be stable lines. And it's just shocking. Those people are either stressed out because of their job, they're not doing other things, spending time with their family. We don't know. Maybe they were unhappy people to begin with. We don't know. But these data suggest that money beyond a certain point maybe is not necessary, or maybe could even, you know, earning more and more could maybe not be a good thing. I'm going to skip the Singapore data because David Chan said be suspicious of these data. Instead, I'm going to tell you briefly what Singapore is good at, and because I want to make sure that we have plenty of time for discussion and questions. And what I see Singapore from the Gallup World Poll primarily, and National Geographic Reporter is going to do an article on Singapore. It's going to come out, I heard, in 9 months. And he interviewed David and he interviewed me. He said, give me some quotes. And why is Singapore the happiest place in Asia? And I said, well, number one, hunger is extremely low. They are developed and they are free and equal, and they have gotten rid of virtually all hunger. That is, people have food. They have ended corruption more than any country in the world, and they have economic growth. And when we asked how many people want to leave, I was shocked because when I talked to the ministers 7 years ago here, they were very worried about people going to America. You know, to move, they're highly talented people. In the Gallup World Poll, 2% said they wanted to leave. Shockingly low. I think it's the lowest in the world. Affordable housing. So now I'm put question mark because you know better than I do. But what I see is there, this is a big worry of people, affordable housing. A very high number of people say that there's not affordable housing here. Employees not feeling respected. I don't know what that means, why that is. The life satisfaction is a bit lower here than you would think. I think it has to do with that stress, and you can't keep up and can't kind of live up to expectations here, which are so high. And then tired and stressed. So a lot of people say, I don't feel rested. I feel tired out. I'm working such long hours. I'm stressed out. I can't quite do enough, etc. So these are the things that I would say that, you know, Singapore's done great, but these are the few things that I would take a more careful look at and worry about a little bit. So David Chan pointed out an interesting thing in his video podcast, excellent video podcast about this same topic in YouTube, in which he said, but all those guys are talking about data that don't come from Singapore. And what we need is Singaporean data or data from each culture in that context. So maybe here, childcare is more important or less important? I don't know, right? We need data from each of these things that I've told you about in terms of, does it really matter here? Does income redistribution matter more in some countries than in others? For example, where there's a lot of mobility, upward mobility possible, maybe it doesn't matter as much probably as where there's very little mobility, and then you've got to have more income redistribution to make sure that everybody's feeling like they're treated fairly. So I think this is pointing to the need for a lot more research on that, on these topics, on all of them, all around the world, but in each culture and in Singapore, and if others of you are from Malaysia and so forth, in each culture to see if these things work. But if they do work, then I think you have an argument. Get rid of air pollution, cut, you know, try to use rezoning to cut down on commuting, increase green space when you can, et cetera. If you want my PowerPoint, I will send it to you. So edeiner@illinois.edu, very, very simple. Just email me and I'll send you the PowerPoint. And I think it has some more slides that I cut out because I knew we were going to be in a big hurry today. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Diener.
Excuse me, sorry. Okay.
I would now like to invite on stage Professor DeMeyer and Professor Chan to join us for the panel discussion. Professors, please. Ladies and gentlemen, before we begin, just some house rules. Please identify yourselves and the organization you are from before posing your questions. There are microphones along the aisles, and our ushers are on hand to pass the wireless mics around. And over to you, Professor DeMeyer.
Thank you very much. And David, because you were on the last slide, quoted as having made an appeal for more research, perhaps I should start by a question and asking you, from your Singapore perspective, how do you react to what Ed Diener has just shared with us about the importance of subjective well-being and how it sort of is translated here in Singapore?
Okay, yeah, thanks.
You've been writing about it, so.
Yeah, well, actually we have quite a bit of research by now in Singapore in terms of not just causes, consequences of well-being, what well-being is, and so on. Well, I had to say that because I want to make sure that we continue to do more research. But we actually have plenty of research, not just by myself, of course, but my colleagues in SMU, people from MANUS, and actually the government agencies, consulting firms and all, have measured well-being for quite a bit. I do have a few reactions off the cuff from hearing the talk, and of course I know Ed's work very well. Ed and I, with Daniel Kahneman and all, I still remember a few years ago we were in New York when we were on an international committee, six of us, put together a report for United Nations, which they kind of use it in the developmental report, the 20th anniversary report. And the reason I brought that up is that in our discussion, actually a lot of the cultural things came up. Right? We, of course, didn't put it into the report for United Nations. We were trying to explain to them the importance of measuring well-being over and above the Human Development Index, meaning you measure purchasing power, education, mortality, and so on, of course, over and above your GDP. So we wanted to ensure that, of course, you can actually compare across cultures. But having said that, I think all of us, of course myself, recognize that there are some important cultural differences that we need to watch out for, right? As we all know, if you try to rank 160 over countries on any metrics, there will be things that are comparable and things that are not. What are comparable? I think the concept of well-being is comparable, that we have a satisfaction cognitive component. I want this, did I get it? Okay, if my wants and preferences are met, I am satisfied. I think that concept is comparable across culture. The concept of happiness is also comparable across culture. Everybody agrees that being joyful, being calm, being relieved are positive emotions, and everyone say anxious, desire, depressed, and anger, and disgust are negative emotions. But the differences come in, I think, on the emotional part quite importantly, because I think in the Asian culture, even in Singapore, many of us, I think, are really quite functioning quite well, pretty happy, but we don't go around smiling that much with a lot of joy and so on. I give you the example of the atypical Asian parents. It's a bit of a stereotype, but many of us know that our parents work very hard. They may not smile a lot, but they feel very accomplished, a sense of meaning when they can say that, well, I'm not rich, I'm never a graduate, but my child has gone to the university, graduated from SMU, and he's having a very good job now, or she is having a very good job now. Of course, it's SMU, right? So And of course, NUS, NTU as well. And SUTD and UNIC, I know you're all in the audience. And I said that to mean that I believe our parents were truly happy and truly satisfied. But they, if you ask them to rate on their joy, elation, they won't be very high. But if you rate them accomplished, contentment, right, then they will be much higher. So that's just the first point. Very quickly, just two more points. I think it's very important to look at ranking across countries, national accounts of well-being. I co-author with Ed, and of course I believe that. But I want to explain one subtle difference. We all care about income inequality and Gini coefficient, right? We are quite bothered that in Singapore it's quite high. But if you look at our Gini coefficient with some other cities or countries, cities is actually a better comparison. Actually, we have higher mobility, social mobility, and our people are less depressed. What I'm trying to say is that, what are we comparing here? So if we were to compare happiness and well-being, and you find that actually Singapore, by the way, is ranked quite good. We are usually ranked in the first one-third or first half and so on. Then if next year I drop my position from, say, 27 to 32, should the government care? Maybe. But maybe you only care social politically, and you care only for those who read the newspapers about the ranking. When you go to the ballot box, nobody cares about are you 27 or 28. Right? When you go to the ballot box and you vote for the government, you ask yourself, how is my life experiences now compared to 5 years ago, 3 years ago? What I'm trying to say is that what is more important for society and the government and people is the intra-societal changes over time in your well-being. What you should care is that right now, compared to in the past, how am I feeling? And over the, do I have hope as I look upon into the future? And I think I will just round it off with this comment that I think government actually has cared about happiness and well-being all this while. But they didn't want to use the word, it sounded a bit fluffy to them. But actually they have been using the word quality of life. They have been using the word that we are doing it for the best interests of Singaporeans and so on. So greenery, when you look at Jurong Lake, when you look at urban forms, when you try to have commuting experience in the MRT to make it better, actually, and trying to involve community, trying to promote volunteerism, these are all your established predictors of well-being, right? And so the government is not dumb, and they are well informed of the research. They actually have access to the research. I think the social political thing, when we thought that government cares about economics and not well-being, is because they never use the word happiness. I think it's just a bias. It sounded fluffy, but it's a matter of time they have been working on it. And I think it's a matter of time, whether you use that concept or not, I don't quite care. I think what I care is that, are you having policies? Our community stepping up to increase the well-being over time. I think that's what that really matters.
Thank you. And Ed, before we open it to questions to the room for both Ed and David, I must say that I was a bit intrigued by that, one of the last graphs where you show that if you go above a certain level of salary, happiness goes down. Of course, one could use that and to talk to the colleagues who have a high salary. You don't need more money because you're going to get unhappy if I give you more money. I'm not going to use that argument. But you yourself said that you sort of were intrigued by the results. Have you more reflections on it? Or?
Yeah, so I have also, so it's just brand new. We just got it, and it's surprising. Because before we found leveling off, and the leveling off's understandable, makes but sense. The going down is not, and we don't understand it. I studied the richest people in 1985 in Forbes list, 400 list, people that are worth, you know, now billions of dollars, in those days only hundreds of millions. Those people were above average in happiness, but they weren't super happy. And they all said things like, what's important to me is my family, I enjoy work, I enjoy taking care of the employees. And a very recent study of CEOs, and these guys are making tens of millions of dollars a year, salary is important to me, not because I need money. I don't need money more. I have $100, $200 million. I don't need money, but it's just sort of a way of keeping score, to know I'm doing well, right? So they do care about it in that sense, but they say what's important to me is making an impact on the world, helping my employees, making my company a more efficient, better company, etc. So yeah, even at that point, money may matter, but it's not the most important thing in an absolute sense. Now, why we got a turndown in these data, I don't know. It could be, you know, we said happiness peaks out. What if it is that the people that make the most money are not the people who are totally satisfied. They're the people who are a little dissatisfied. So there could be something like that going on where the causality goes the other way. It could be stress. It could be that these people just are, if you make that much money in the United States or Singapore, it's not extraordinary. You can be a hard worker and maybe, if you're highly educated, make that much money. But in the world, maybe most of those people who make that much money are extraordinary, and they might be working night and day. They may be in very stressful jobs, mm-hmm. et cetera. So we just don't know.
Interesting. I'm going to open it for questions from the audience. As the rules are, try to introduce yourself and keep the questions short. And questions, not statements, right? Yeah, I have a question over there. There will be an usher with a microphone.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I'm Gail. I worked at the UN before this on the Sustainable Development Goals. I now work for the government. I'm from GovTech, which uses technology for public service delivery. And because this is a talk on subjective well-being and public policy, my question is, how can we use the vocabulary of equity and fairness when talking about SWB? So for example, and I have two examples. One, if I'm very poor, but I'm happy, what does that mean? And if I drive a Ferrari to work, but I'm very unhappy, what should the government do? What does intervention look like on that level? And maybe that first example is unfair. So let me use the second example then. When you mention elections, I think maybe it is fluffy, and maybe it's also an issue of methodological soundness. So when I ask you at the ballot box, are you happy with life? Your memory is affected by time. Is that something we should care about as a metric of subjective well-being when how much income you've had in the past 6 days versus 6 years makes a difference? And your mood for that day also made a difference.
Yeah, so let me answer both of those, and then David probably has some things to say too. So let's start out with sustainable goals, the UN and stuff, and turn to a person that they all love, Amartya Sen, who I have been around a little bit. And let me answer him then in this way. We don't want people to be happy. We want them to have functioning and capability and educate them and so forth. And then whether they're happy or not, that's not important. I say, yeah, no, it is important for the reasons I pointed out. And sure, those other things are important too. But if you said a person could be educated and have all kinds of capabilities, but they're miserably depressed and want to commit suicide, that is the same as the same person with those capabilities who now enjoys life? No, of course you can't say that. So other things being equal, we're not saying happiness is more important than those other things. So I'm going to give you an example of a guy by the name of Manoj, who we interviewed. He's a rickshaw driver in Calcutta. He makes $1, $2, $3 a day. His family can't always eat. So he's very, very poor. We interviewed a lot of these people and gave them our scales. So if you said to Manoj, are you happy? He'd say, yeah. Are you satisfied with your life? Pretty satisfied. You say, how can this be? Amartya Sen's right. No, he'd say, no, I'm not satisfied with my income. I really wish I made more income. But don't forget, my income alone does not define me. I have my kids and my wife, and I love them a great deal. And when I can give them even the littlest thing, it makes me happy. I have my friends. I have my religion. I am not defined by my poverty alone. That's how we get that. But would he want more income? Would he be wanting his kids to get a better job? Of course he would. So just because people in Costa Rica are happier than people in Korea doesn't mean that they wouldn't want to have more income just because their social life happens to be very good too. So that would be my first question. The second question I probably spent 10 years studying, and that is the scales and the validity of the scales. And I have, if any of you want to go to my website, you can download articles. I have a review of the validity of life satisfaction scales. I would give the scales a B, maybe a B minus, but I give GDP a B minus too. So they're pretty good. Do they have some potential faults? Current mood that you mentioned can influence it. It's usually in our data a very small influence. It's not as big as you would think. People can discount it. They know when they're in a better or worse mood for them. The other thing is you would never collect data on the national holiday when everybody's in a great mood, right? And then in another country on a down day, right? So you're able to control these things, and you can even measure
current mood and see and control it and see if you get differences. We have all kind. There's hundreds of measurement biases. So in the 2008 book that I wrote on policy measures of well-being, we answer all of these different problems, talk about measurement validity and so forth. And I notice some of you out there look a little sleepy. And so if you have sleep problems, read this book, because this book will put you to sleep for sure. It is the most boring book. But it goes through every one of those questions and answers them. And we've got more recent stuff as well.
What's the name of the book? The title of the book?
Well-being for Public Policy.
So you can go to Google and find Amazon.com. David, any...
By the way, as you grow older, you need less sleep in order to achieve the same level of happiness. And also, when you are an adolescent, and all the research is quite clear, you actually need more sleep. So be careful with the way you deal with your kids. About night homework and so on. Actually, I think the question has two levels. You use fairness, justice, and equity more or less interchangeably. Well, if you look at the research, you should distinguish it at the individual level and the societal level. Now, at the individual level, what we are concerned with citizens or employees is their perceived fairness, their fairness perception. The research is very clear. If I perceive that I'm treated fairly, the chances is that I'm going to trust the person that I'm attributing fairness to as well as happiness. So if I think my boss treats me fairly, chances is I'm going to trust him rather than not trust him, and my life experiences is going to be enjoyable and so on. And that's why in organizational climate survey, we spend a lot of time trying to ask you whether you think the outcome is fair, whether you trust your bosses, are you trusting the person's competence, the person's integrity, or his or her benevolence. That, in other words, does the president mean what he say? Does he say what he means? That's benevolence, which is quite different from integrity or competence. So when we make sure, what we want to make sure is our employees, our citizens, your spouses, your friends actually perceive you as giving the person fair treatment, right? We don't have time to go into the details of what is fair, unfair. There's a whole host of research in it. But when it comes to policy, the societal fairness and justice is quite different. If you look at our government, actually their manifesto is that you want Singapore to be a fair and just society. And what does that really mean? That means it is not an equal society. Because it is a foolish government to think that you want an equal society. You can never be equal. And one would say that if you believe in meritocracy, you cannot believe in equality, right? Because the better married person should have a better reward and so on. So the question is not about equity and fairness. It's first never about equality, at least in a meritocratic and capitalist society. It is about, do the people get what they expect? And do the person think that if I put in my effort according to my core values like meritocracy, I will get what I expect? So it is about hope. And if the lower income person feel that I have social mobility, it feels that, yes, you are driving a Ferrari, I'm not, but it's okay if I work hard and if I want a Ferrari, I think I can possibly actually do it. But if I choose not to do it, it's fine, I'll do something else. I'll take a bus and I'll be happy. Right now, if people can feel like this, I would argue that you would have achieved a just and fair society. Now, the tricky part, and I'll end with this, is that our meritocracy notion has been performance-based. In other words, government has been saying, well, you do well, I reward you. You don't do well, I'm sorry, I can't reward you. For a while, it has been okay. But structurally and sociologically, we all know that social mobility has gone down because the rich parents will give the rich kids resources. So I may be smart, but if my parents are not rich, I'm going to have less resources. My cognitive development as a kid is going to be affected. So it's not that I don't have potential or I'm not smart. The fairness issue now has moved from performance to access to opportunity. Now, if you forget about that meritocracy is just based on performance, but it's also based on fairness, then you realize that fairness is about the outcome, fairness is about the procedure, it's about performance, but it is also about access to opportunity. Then you will begin to realize that elected president, then you begin to realize that when I give money to the poor, it is not just unmeritocratic.
Let's not get into the elected presidency. yes, I have a question over there. Yeah, John. Thank you for the question.
We talked about a kind of inequality and
can
income.
You just, I know oh, well,
I'm
you
sorry,
are,
yeah,
John.
You know but me, but not everybody yeah. else does. John Donaldson, I'm here at this wonderful university and the School of Social Sciences, a political scientist. And I look a lot at, you know, sort of the differences between poverty and GDP and things like that. I was wondering if there's a way to calculate, or if you've already calculated, sort of a Gini coefficient in societies on subjective well-being. In other words, not the impact of inequality on it, but whether, you know, in societies where some people are happy, some people are not, versus, you know, societies where it's fairly sort of evenly distributed, the distribution
yes.
of happiness.
So we have looked at Gini coefficient, And Ruud Veenhoven in Netherlands has as well. And what we find is that it tends to go with low well-being, so much higher inequality in low well-being countries. And part of that is, of course, just the fact that standard deviation is often larger when, Denmark, for example, at 8 on a 10-point scale, mm-hmm. so close to the top, you can't have too much variability. And when you look at, the distribution of individuals in Denmark, you can see it there, right? There's only hardly anybody at 5 and below. Then you look at some of the African countries, and of course, they may average 4, but there are some 8s, and there are some 1s there. It's really big. So inequality of it is correlated with low well-being.
Yeah. Oh, brilliant talk! I really had fun together with Steve.
I'm going to ask you to introduce yourself. Although 90% of
Tan Chin Tiong, SMU. Yeah. In one of your slides, is that funny? In one of your slides, Singapore youth rated importance of wealth, number one, yes. Importance of happiness, number one. Youth finishing school, get a job, not likely to make a lot of money. And as a result, many of them become somewhat unhappy. That's point number one. Point number two, on happiness, is there a gender difference?
Yeah,
are the guys more happy than girls, or the other way around?
Yeah, so I can tell you that we looked at the Gallup World Poll, and what we found is that women were happier in 72 nations, and men were happier in 70, and the differences were never large. There are very small differences across the world across gender. Furthermore, they're not always what you would expect. For example, in Saudi Arabia, women came out slightly happier than men. Now, we would say, oh my God, the data are wrong. The measures, there's something wrong with the measures. Because we think, oh, women can't drive there and they have these certain restrictions there. But what we believe is that women in very traditional societies have a very secure role. They are good at that role. They are socialized in that role. And they are in charge of that, say the household. And it is much more, in a way, you're able to do it well and securely than being out there in the real world where some things can get nasty. Then over in Sweden, women are pretty happy too because they're almost equal, right? It's very close. Men still may have a few advantages, but they're very close. It's in the in-between time when you're coming out and starting to enter the workforce and so forth, but men still have great advantages in the workforce, where you really get women to come down. So there's two groups where they're doing okay, and then a group where they're not doing as well. That's sort of what our hypothesis is. We have some data to support that, but the differences are surprise. I've been shocked by them, that they weren't bigger and they weren't in the direction I thought.
But the first question was also, does this perception of happiness over income change over the lifetime of people? I mean, that's...
Yeah. And of course, people's expectations are huge. So when you judge your own income, you judge it based on several things. What maybe your parents' income was, where you grew up, maybe what your income was last year or 2 years ago, workers around you. One of the things we find is your satisfaction with your salary doesn't depend on where you stand in society. It depends where you stand on within your kind of work. So if you're a surgeon who's making $150,000 in the U.S., it's not like, oh, I'm elated because I'm making more than almost everybody. No, most surgeons are making $200,000. I'm unhappy. So people do a lot of comparison within their group. But I do fear that what you were alluding to is that people think they're going to make a whole lot of money, and now they're coming out into a workforce where they may not make as much money. They're going to be disappointed. It's more competitive. There's fewer jobs. For example, in academia in the U.S., many of them are not hireable now. We turn out too many PhDs, et cetera. So those kind of dashed expectations. One of the things that an economist from Brookings showed is that you can be disappointed even if you're making a lot of money. So she looked at what she called high achievers in Chile and South America, and these people were making like four times more income than their parents. Huge, right? Just going up. They were disappointed in their income. They were dissatisfied. Why? American TV, right? They see, oh, wait. I'm making $40,000 a year. My parents made $10,000 a year. I'm making $40,000. Oh, my gosh, but I don't have, you know, all this stuff that I see that Americans have and so forth. And by the way, there are data to show that TV, and I would say American TV around the world, when you see that, people start comparing not with Americans, but the lifestyle you see on American TV, and that becomes one of the comparison bases.
I think when you look at across times in Singapore, many countries, the level of satisfaction is relatively stable, but there is actually generation effect, meaning that over time, what makes you happy is going to change. So the predictor of the happiness or well-being can change. You may want more time now, you know, your parents may don't mind having less time, but now you want more time. But the level of happiness will still remain relatively stable because human beings are generally adaptive. You look for what you want, you cannot get, then you go and get some, you get some, don't get, then you'll be unhappy. So the mean will still be stable, but the what makes you happy can change over your lifespan as well as across generations.
The good news, by the way, is we don't watch American TV here, we watch Korean TV.
American Koreans.
Which may not be that well for our well-being when I saw the statistics. Are there any questions? Yes.
I am Chao Chen from SMU. I noticed that religiosity was not featured as a predictor of well-being in your slides. I'm aware that in one of your recent papers, you mentioned that religiosity may not be so important in a prosperous nation. Would you like to share your view about this matter?
Religiosity, religious consciousness.
Religious consciousness. Oh, so huge differences between societies. We show something interesting. So most data show that religious people are happier because most studies are done in the USA, which is a pretty religious place. What we showed went beyond that, Louis Tay and I, Singaporean by birth, that in fact, religious people are really happy in religious nations. And in non-religious nations, it doesn't matter. So if you're in Sweden, you may be a little happier if you're non-religious, because only 20% of people there say they're 15-20%, very low. If you're in Saudi Arabia, you better be religious, because 98% say religion is very important, and I went to services this week. So it's extremely high. If you're non-religious there, it's bad for your happiness. But what we also show is that religiosity has been dropping as countries have become economically developed. And if you look at the predictors of the level of overall religiosity in a country, hunger, conflict, a variety of things. So it seems like, and I want to be careful because I know many people here are very religious, is that people are drawn more strongly to religion in difficult circumstances. And it helps in those circumstances to be religious.
I think it's contextual. It depends if you are very religious. It depends whether your society allow you to manifest those religious values. So if you are in Singapore and you have a particular religion that everybody is fine and you can express and manifest and practice them freely, I think you'll be pretty okay. But if you are in a country whereby your religious conviction, of course, have problems in terms of practicing, and then you will be always trying to think about collective movements, protests, and so on. So I think the religiosity part, of course, we know there's a sensitivity part of it, that when you are too religious, if there's such a thing, right? And when your religion contradicts with certain secular values of how a society functions, that obviously will affect your well-being because you will have very misfit of values about you person versus a society fit and so on. One final point is about meaning, right? The research on meaning shows that the source of your meaning is not as important as whether you have a meaning or not. So if you have meaning through religion, fine. If I have meaning by being a professor, doing knowledge, fine. If you have meaning helping people, fine. And we will be all happier than those guys that cannot still searching and could not find his or her meaning. Right? So having a meaning or not is more important than the source of your meaning. So do not get misled to say religious people will always be happier because they have more meaning than the non-religious. The question is, do you have a meaning? Have you found your own meaning? And if you have found it, the research shows that that is what that matters. The source and pathways of meaning is less important so long as it is not maladaptive to society and yourself.
And by the way, let me just mention one thing real quickly. We found that college students who said they were having a lot of fun drinking and all this kind of stuff, but no meaning in life, they were doing very badly. They went to the counseling center more often. They went to the health center more often. Their friends and family thought their life satisfaction was lower. So having a lot of fun,
it's not the same.
Yeah.
I have a question over there, yeah.
Hi, my name is Ben. I am an alumni from SMU. I like to think that my parents are fairly happy for having me graduated from here. So to Prof. Diener, I'm not too sure. I have a bit of confusion down here. I'm not too sure whether it's justified or founded. So on one hand, you allude to how the structural factors are a bit more influential, a bit more weighty in terms of determining happiness in a country. So for example, trees, trains, no provisions, stability, corruption, external factors. And on the other hand, Prof. David probably did allude to expectations, personal meaning, and if I could quote Viktor Frankl in his book, Man's Search for Meaning, which is when we are not able to change the situation, we are challenged to change ourselves. So it seems to suggest that the notion of self, the personal expectations, the personal management of happiness seems to be heavier, more important. So I'm kind of confused, and all boils down to, are we lost in this entire equation of searching for happiness? So to put it in Singapore's context, instead of building more trains, should we be teaching our children, teaching our people to be happier, to look at things on the bright side when our trains do break down?
So people have been arguing about this for not centuries, but millennia. It's all in your head, Epictetus. It's not so much things that matter, but what you think of them. And in our Gallup World Poll, Zimbabwe and Denmark almost don't overlap in their distributions of happiness. So to say that conditions don't matter to me seems silly. But also, of course, what's in your mind. Some people are born with a happier temperament. We know that from genetic studies, heritability studies. Some people are born happier, and some people learn to be happier. We know that meditation, for example, people who are very right frontal, active in their brain, meaning they're probably predisposed to be happiness, you can get that way through meditation, increase that. So we know that both of these, I mean, it's like, which is more important for, let's say, your height, your genetics, or eating protein? Both of them are important. Both of them are important. So both of these things can be important. Many of the philosophies that came from 2,000, 2,500 years ago had to do with dealing with very difficult conditions. People are starving. People are dying of all kinds of diseases. You have no control over your environment. So a lot of it had to be within you. But now we have the ability to also change society. So yes, it still has to be within you from some extent. And we're giving a course right now looking at interventions to help people think about the world in a more positive way, increase their happiness. So we certainly believe some of it's within you. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that politicians can say, well, it's all within you, so therefore we can just do what we want. Because society does matter. Society, you think you're in Syria and it doesn't matter right now? Of course it matters a lot for your happiness. So I think it's not a conflict. Both of them matter a lot.
There's no contradiction at all. If you look at it statistically, when you compare across country societies, your unit of analysis is not the individual. It's a society. So you take the mean. You're just comparing the average, right? And you just assume, you know, it's not like a statistical and all, you just assume, you compare the mean, and then you say, okay, there are differences, and the factors, structural factors come out. Now, within the same society, the conditions are not the same, right? You do not live the same way as a person who is very, very rich or a person who is very, very poor. So our life experiences within Singapore actually are different. Although we are small, it's not the same. And those life experiences matter. So whether you are between or within the country, actually the life experiences matter. In psychology, we tell people there is no such thing as situation and individual. Everything is an interaction between the situation and the individual. You put David Chan here and David Chan in Bhutan, I will operate completely differently. I will be quite sad in Bhutan, and I'll be quite happy in Singapore, right? But I'm still me, and that's because it is the interaction between me and what I've gotten used to and so on. Should we ask people to get used to breakdown of trains? I will put it this way. Yes, it is good to be resilient because trains will break down for anything that matter. It is good to learn to deal with failures and all, but there are tipping points. If I attribute that the breakdown of trains is because, you know, you don't have good materials and you break this down and you break it down again just when you told me that you invested so much, it matters because I will lose trust in your competence. And therefore, you want to build resilience, you want to build ownership, but you just have to do some hygiene factors because, especially in Singapore, we have pride ourselves to be a very competent and efficient society. The expectations are indeed quite high, and I'm afraid you have to maintain it.
I have one more question over there, right?
Yep. Hi, yeah. I'm Dustin from Health Promotion Board. Are there any studies on how terrorism has affected a country's well-being, and how can an individual and also a country protect its well-being from a crisis?
Terrorism.
So, and Damon may know the studies better than I do because I don't know the studies well. I can't tell you the authors. But there are some data to show that when terrorist acts happen, you see reactions in the well-being data, and you see where there is more terrorism, controlling for other factors, income and so forth at that place, that you do see somewhat lower well-being. Of course, there's many factors influencing the well-being of every place. How you can protect against that, maybe I'd let David conjecture on that, but one of the first things I think for, say in America, to realize is your chance of being killed by a terrorist are minuscule. I mean, your chance of being killed in almost any other way is greater than being killed by a terrorist. You're going around and not worrying about people driving while they're texting. You better worry about people driving while they're texting a whole lot more than you better worry about terrorists, because they are much more of a threat to you. They're going to kill you much more often. So I don't know if that's convincing. I wouldn't be very good at it. You know, if I were the president, I'd say, don't think about terrorists, right? Start worrying about the real problems. But I would never be elected. But the thing is, that's the truth, right? To understand that.
Quick reaction, David.
Yes, very quickly. I agree with Ed that statistically you will die not from terrorism, from something else. But as a society, it is extremely important for a small society, because when a terrorism occurs and you cannot come back, a lot of your social fabric, such as trust between races, is going to demolish. It will have enormous consequence on your subsequent living and functioning, say, within Singapore, who one of the things that brings us together is multiculturalism. Right, so I would just say that, and I would also say that after September 11, actually psychological research, scientific and rigorous one on resilience, just shot up. Right? There were lots of centers set up and all, and people begin to realize that the way to address not only terrorism but crisis is to look at prevention, response and recovery. We are quite good at prevention. If you look at any university's crisis emergency committee, they have a lot of prevention guidelines. They also, some have response guidelines. Very few have recovery guidelines. Okay, and I think what we are lacking is in the recovery part that we got to work hard on.
Let me just make clear. So in the US, well-being went up right after 9/11 because of Americans pulled together. They really felt together in a strong way. But I think in general, overall, in the long run, there's a lot of negative reaction to terrorists in your area in the long run.
I guess there are also quite some studies in France that showed that after the first big bomb attacks, the well-being went up. But after the second or the third ones that had happened, well-being went down because the population was very unhappy with the way the government had been able to manage this. Ed, before we close this, I have one more question that I sort of want to raise with you. That is, you've used a few times the example of Zimbabwe on one hand and Denmark on the other hand. Let me just say I understand why Zimbabwe is that end of the spectrum. I have nothing against, I hope there are no Danes in the room, but I'm a bit puzzled about Denmark.
Everybody is. Well, because they're not uproariously happy, right? When you go there, they seem kind of content and so forth. I'll tell you what, it's got some of the same things that Singapore has. It has extremely low corruption, extremely high social trust. So we ask the question, if you lose your wallet, would a stranger return it?
would a police officer return it? And would your next door neighbor return it? In Zimbabwe, say nobody would return it, right? In Denmark, they say yes, all of them would return it. A stranger would return my wallet. They have social trust. They have low corruption. They have high social support. Of course, they have advantages. Very homogeneous society, for one thing, that we don't have in America. And that probably makes it easier to have social trust and social support. But they're really high in that. And of course, they're high in feeling that they're dealt with equitably in terms of equity, right? They're a socialistic society and pretty extreme on that end, although maybe not as extreme as they used to be. And they're economically developed, so they sort of have it all in that sense. Even though I don't think they're uproariously happy, they're not the highest in positive affect. They're the highest in life satisfaction.
Okay. On that note, I think I need to bring this to a conclusion. This was a very interesting lecture and a set of questions, and I'm not going to try to summarize it. But what I do want to emphasize is that this is an excellent example of how rigorous research, really well-grounded rigorous research, that it can help also in actually in our policies and in our thinking about well-being, and sort of that relevance of the output of the research is also very important. It is a very good indicator of what we as a university should and aspire to do. Thank you, Ed, for giving us this great lesson. Thank you.